Welcome to Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church, and thank you for being a part of our television ministry. Pulaski Heights is a place of warmth and love, with an outreach mission that extends far beyond our church walls. We have a long tradition of offering our hearts, stretching our minds, and extending Christ's hands to those in need. We are a congregation of hope and an open place of worship that seeks to share the good news beyond the conventional barriers of fellowship.
Hi, I'm Britt Scarta, senior pastor at Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church. It is our desire that you will be inspired by today's message of hope for a diverse community in search of God's love.
Greetings. For over 100 years, our worshiping community at Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church has thrived on being physically present to one another. With this global health crisis, now it is our calling to serve our neighbors at home and from a distance. As the body of Christ, we can still build a community of love that worships through our witness to the world, even from afar. Thank you for worshiping with us. We join with me in prayer. O God of love and God of power, we come to you in this time of need. You are the great physician, and we place our well-being in your hands. Guide us and lead your people to a brave new world, one of world of hope and love and care. Amen.
Church that evermore.
Be merciful to me, O God, says the psalmist. Be merciful to me, for you, my soul, takes refuge. In the shadow of your wings, I will take refuge. Until the destroying storms pass by, I don't know what storms may be passing by in your life, but you have come to the right place at the right time, and you are welcome here. In this time and moment of change, let us say to one another, the peace of Christ be with us all.
Storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the world is tossing me like a ship upon the sea, thou who rulest wind and water, stand by me.
I invite you to join with me in the Psalter, which is Psalm 23, a very familiar and loving psalm, and we'll sing a response.
My shepherd is the Lord, nothing indeed shall I want. My shepherd is the Lord, nothing indeed shall I want.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures, leads me beside still waters, restores my life, leads me in right paths for the sake of the Lord's name. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
My shepherd is the Lord, nothing indeed shall I want.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord as long as I live.
My shepherd is the Lord, nothing indeed shall I want.
You may be seated. At this time, I would like to invite Mrs. Cindy Burns, who is our minister to children and their families, to come forward and share with us a lesson for young Christians.
Good morning, boys and girls. My name is Cindy, and I'm just so happy and so thankful to see each of you this morning. I want each of you to know how very special you are. I want each of you to know how very loved you are. So for our children's message today, I thought it would be fun to bring some of my stuffed animals. Boys and girls, since I was your age, I have loved stuffed animals. Maybe some of you all love stuffed animals. I need to tell you kind of a funny story. This is a pink poodle. Actually, he's lost an eye, but sometimes that makes a stuffed animal even more lovable. Years ago, I think it was maybe 20 years ago, it was Mother's Day. And I'd been thinking, what am I going to get my wonderful mother for Mother's Day? And then I was in a store. I saw this pink poodle. Thought Mother would love that. We had a poodle at one time when I was in junior high and high school. And so I just thought, I'm going to get this for Mother. So on Mother's Day, I gave it to her and she loved it. But this is the awesome part of the story. Guess what happened? We have a daughter. And our daughter gave me the exact same gift for Mother's Day. Isn't that wonderful? Probably some of your stuffed animals have stories too. And it's fun when we look at the stuffed animals we have and we think about who gave them to us. Stuffed animals have always brought me a lot of comfort. Boys and girls, something else that brings me a tremendous amount of comfort is the gift of prayer. I know right now we might not be in school. We might not be seeing our friends. We might not be seeing our grandparents, people that we really love. But boys and girls, God has given us an amazing gift, the gift of prayer. Prayer and God are with us always, 24/7. No matter where we are, no matter how we're feeling, God is with us. And we have this gift of prayer. Prayer is a way to love another person. I want to look in the Bible. The Bible's amazing. Paul wrote a letter years ago, a long time ago. 1 Thessalonians, the 5th chapter, the 17th verse. Pray without ceasing. What that means, what Paul was telling the Thessalonians, always pray. Pray all the time. There are many reasons I love the Bible, but one of the main reasons I love the Bible, it was written a long time ago, boys and girls, but what we read in the Bible means so much and applies to us in March 2020. So let's just think about prayer. Prayer is really talking to God. We can pray anytime. There's no right way to pray. There's no wrong way to pray. Sometimes people say, I'm not the praying type. I'm not comfortable praying. There's no right way to do it. It is simply in our minds. We can say it silently in our hearts, or we can say it aloud. But it's taking, let's say we're praying for another person. We just take that person in our heart. Can be someone you really love. One thing I do sometimes when I'm praying for someone I love is I'll have that image of them in my mind. It's like I can see them. It's almost like looking at a picture. You can look at a picture. And I just visualize light all around that person. And as I pray for them, I am praying that that person I'm praying for, that they will feel God's love. I know there have been times in my life where people have prayed for me, and I have felt it. That's a gift from God. So a gift you can give yourself, your friends, is to pray. And to remember you can pray anytime, anywhere. Like Paul said, we just want to live in a spirit of prayer, especially right now. Especially right now, with things being different from how they usually are. Boys and girls, to close today, and thank you so much for being part of this children's message. Thank you for just your gift of how you teach us all. We learn from our children how to just love God. But I wanted to close this children's message. And I wanted to close with a prayer. And I thought that we would do an interactive prayer. I want us first to pray for those who are in the health professional field. For our nurses, our doctors, all the staff at a hospital, at a lab, our scientists. Right now, they're dealing with a lot. So that's who we're going to pray for first. I'm going to say that, and then we're going to be silent. You can say out loud, or you can just say in your heart, but we're going to pause. And then I want you to say a prayer for someone or several people whom you love. And we'll pause. And then I want you to say a prayer for you. Boys and girls, the best thing that any of us can do is to take the best care of ourselves that we can. And then at the end, I'm going to say amen. So let's put our prayer hands together. I always love to put prayer hands together. I love what it signifies. We put our hands like this, and they're just going up to God. And that's really so important. So let's put our prayer hands together. Boys and girls, in our hearts or out loud, let's say a prayer for all of our health professionals who are helping those people who are sick. We want to pray for those in Little Rock, in the United States, and around the world. Now, boys and girls, let's say a prayer for someone you just love so much. It might be someone who's watching this service with you. It might be somebody who lives somewhere else. But just say a prayer for people whom you love. And feel free, boys and girls, to say their name out loud as we pause, or say them in your heart. God hears all of our prayers. And boys and girls, say a very special prayer for yourself. Pray that during this time, all of us will grow closer to God. That we'll take this time to read our Bibles and pray. And that this can be a time of deep spiritual growth for all of us. In Christ's name, amen. Boys and girls, thank you so much for being with us today, and know how loved you are. Take good care of yourself, and remember to pray.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, oh my, our world has turned upside down. Many of us are struggling to make sense of this pandemic and the response that we're called to end it. We are a social people, and distancing ourselves from others is not easy. Balancing work and children is not easy. We worry about our jobs and if they will be there when this is all over. We worry about our loved ones and the very real possibility of illness and death. We are in survival mode, which takes energy and stamina. But we are assured, O God, that you are with us in this struggle. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear your divine presence with us. Give us courage to do what is necessary, and give us peace that we will find a way to the other side. In this difficult time, O Lord, we see that our whole world is in this together. Our prescribed barriers to one another, race, gender, religion, and country are brought down by this pandemic that leaves no one untouched. So we have the opportunity to think and pray for all of those around the world who are in the same struggle. Today we pray for healthcare workers who are on the front lines, giving of themselves selflessly to care for those who are sick. We pray for those on the margins of society whose access to childcare is even more difficult than normal. We pray for families who are grieving the loss of loved ones that have been taken by this disease. We pray also for those in our midst who have lost loved ones recently. We offer our Christian sympathy to Patrick Thomas Scheck and family in the death of his father, Thomas Scheck, and to R.T. Findlay and family in the death of his mother, Larice Dollar, to Hope Hankins and family in the death of her husband, Tommy Hankins, to the family and friends of Arminta Berry in her recent death, to Mike Moore and family in the death of his mother, Carolyn Moore, to Sherry Bird and family in the death of her mother, Dorothy Gavin, to Harriet Pollock and family in the death of her mother, Annabelle Bracey, to the family and friends of Brenda Joyce Kate Clark in her recent death, to Susan McGowan and Julia Garcia and families in the death of their mother, Carolyn Hensley, and to Karen Clark and family in the death of her brother, Patrick Qualheim. We pray for those who are sick near and far, and for these that have been hospitalized recently, Dickie Lunsford, Billy Sims, and Charlotte Miller Couch. Remind us every day, O Lord, that even in the midst of great difficulty, there are so many things to be grateful for. The beauty of your creation, the sweetness of birds' song, and croaking frogs. We give you thanks for the ability to reach out to one another through technology. Lord, you are full of grace and mercy, and we praise your holy name as we lift all these prayers to you in the sweet name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
You are invited to stand as you are able for the reading of the scripture, which is Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10 in the New Testament. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you once lived, following the course of the world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses. And we were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raises us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places with Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
Let's face it, we are living in a fearful time, aren't we? The COVID-19 pandemic has swept the world like wildfire, and every day we wake to a sobering new reality. A new outbreak in this part of the world, a rising death toll in that part of the world, financial repercussions, and the news that it will probably get worse before it gets better. And we don't deal well with this kind of uncertainty, do we? We don't deal with it very well. We're fearful. We ask ourselves, what's going to happen in the next few months or the next few weeks or today or God knows, even in the next 5 minutes. We're fearful. We're frightened of that which we cannot control and wrap our heads around and manage. It's there. But there was a time. There was a time when much of life was uncontrollable. The gospel writer John says the wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it's come from or where it is going. Today we know. Today we have meteorologists who will tell us which way the wind is blowing or will not blow. I mean, there was a time when the gender reveal of a new baby came at that point of birth. It's a boy or it's a girl, the doctor or midwife would cry out as the baby was delivered from the mother's womb. But not anymore. Not anymore. We have ultrasound and we know that baby's gender months in advance. There was a time when our telephone would ring and we would ask ourselves, now who in the world could that be? But caller ID has taken care of this. Harvard psychologist Daniel Gilbert says that while we really can't control things, we really can't predict, we cannot know the future, still and all, we try to control it, don't we? We try to control it. We make appointments. And we pay into our retirement fund, and yes, we book that cruise to Bermuda. But then something happens, and the stock market crashes, or a pandemic breaks out, or a car runs a red light, and suddenly everything changes. Everything is different. There are no guarantees, are they? There are no guarantees in life, and it's what makes life so difficult and so hard and so painful. There just are no guarantees, well, except for one. There is one guarantee. God. God is with us. in life, in death, in life beyond death, we can count on God. God is always there present to lift us up and hold us no matter what happens. I mean, this is why Jesus came to us as the embodiment, the physical presence of God, to shore us up and lift us and embrace us, even in those moments we just thought we were as good as dead. The writer of Ephesians puts it this way, but God, who is rich in mercy out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. And this is the good news. The good news is that God loves us and saves us and embraces us. And there's nothing we can do about it. It's called grace. It's a free gift. And all we have to do is just accept it and believe it. I love the way Christian author Frederick Buechner puts it. Buechner writes, here is the world. Beautiful and terrible things will happen. Don't be afraid. I am with you. Nothing can ever separate us. I love you, God. God has given this gift of grace and love to our lives, but God has given us something else. God has given us this other important gift, and it is also spelled out for us in this letter to the Ephesians. Listen again to these words. For we are what God has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God has prepared beforehand to be our way of life. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. While salvation is not something we can earn, it's a free gift from God. We just have it. It's just there. It's present. There is this other gift that we've received. And it's a gift that we can grab hold and we can develop. It's the gift of service. The gift of loving and serving others, even as Christ came to love and serve us. I think so often we want to boil Christian discipleship down to a simple formula, like being a good Christian is about being in church 1 hour on Sunday morning, or being a good Christian is about reading various Bible passages throughout the week. And don't get me wrong, these are all well and good. They're very important in and of themselves. In fact, this Lenten sermon series that we're in the middle of right now, Get Fit, Five Essential Practices for Christians, focuses on five ingredients, five things that we can develop in order to be stronger, bolder, more faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. In the first week, we looked at Sunday morning worship. We looked at worship, the power of the gathered community of Christ. There's nothing like it. The second week, we looked at Scripture, the power of God's Word to transform not only our lives, but the world. And now today, we're looking at service. God's power in our lives to be the hands and feet of Christ to a hurting world. I think it's ironic that in the midst of this climate, in the midst of this global pandemic, where we dare not gather together to worship in community, in corporate worship, when we dare not meet with our weekly Bible study group, maybe it's service. Maybe service is where we can shine. Maybe service is where we can offer our witness for Christ. I mean, think about it. Think about this pandemic. Think about those who are helping. Think about doctors and nurses and healthcare workers out there risking their lives. Some have already sacrificed their lives to the virus. in order to bring healing and wholeness. They're our new heroes. Recently, we learned that beloved actor Tom Hanks tested positive for the coronavirus, and he and his wife Rita Wilson are cloistered away, quarantined in Australia. But this past week, Tom Hanks gave a shout out to the servants, to those who give, and he did it by channeling his most recent movie character, Mr. Rogers, by saying, "Look to the helpers. We say thanks for the helpers." In the Bible, if the Bible is a story of God's unconditional love for us, and it is, it's all about God's love for us in Jesus Christ. If the Bible is about God's unconditional love for us, then there is a subplot to this book. And the subplot is all wrapped up in our love for God, our response to God, our giving back to God and to neighbor. This is how we respond. And while, admittedly, we human beings don't do so well with this, we also so often fail and fall short. Still, the Bible is filled with stories of faithful servants who risk life and limb to follow God. I think about characters like Noah and Abraham and Sarah and Moses. God called them to pick up and go and build or do or whatever. And though some were reluctant and some even fought back, they did it. They went and they changed the world by being servants. I think about the prophet Isaiah there in the temple in the midst of turmoil and strife in ancient Israel. And God cries out and says, "Who is there who will serve? Who will go for me?" And Isaiah responds, "Here I am, Lord. Send me, I'll go." And Isaiah went. I think about a young girl named Mary, who God asked to serve by carrying the Messiah, the Savior of the world, in her womb, by asking her to give birth to that child and raise that child and ultimately look on in horror and anguish as that child died on a cross. I think about all these. Jesus said, "Whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, just as I came not to be served, but to serve." Yeah, life is filled with so many uncertainties. We don't know what's going to happen next, and every turn brings something different. But one thing we can count on is whatever corner we take, whatever turn we take, God is present. And God's servants and helpers are also present. And you and I, we can be servants as well. We can change the world by loving and serving God and neighbor. There's so many ways to do it. Miss Cindy Burns mentioned it earlier. The number one thing is prayer. Prayer is the greatest tool we have as people of faith. It can change the world. It's time to pray. It's time to pray for healing and hope and an end to this pandemic. We can also engage in best practices. We can separate ourselves from others, not emotionally, not spiritually, not from the heart, but we can physically distance ourselves from others in order to guarantee the health of our neighbor and our own health. But we don't have to be distant. We can be very social. We don't have to see someone face to face. We can pick up a phone, or we can use other social media to reach out. I mean, there's nothing more reassuring than another human voice. We can talk to our neighbors. We can talk to family members. We can especially reach out to those we feel may be alone and may not hear from anyone. This is our calling. We can be careful about the way we use our resources. Don't overbuy. Don't hoard. Don't stockpile things for the end of the world, because it's not here. It's going to pass. This is going to pass. Think about others. Just use your resources and give. Give. If you have the ability to give, give. Give to those recovery efforts. Give to those who are lost their jobs. Give to your faith community. Give to the church. Make a difference. Use your life for good. And then finally, we can all be, as people of faith, a non-anxious presence. We can model the peace of Christ, which passes all understanding. And this, in and of itself, will literally change the world. I love the way Ephesians puts it. For we are what he made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. 30 years ago, this very summer, I found myself in rural Appalachia doing hands-on mission work with a group of teenagers from this congregation. It was a powerful week. During that week in that impoverished part of the world, we shored up dilapidated houses that were on the verge of collapse. We added plumbing to homes that had never, ever had plumbing before. We installed insulation in walls in anticipation of the coming harsh winter. And we built relationships with some of the most disadvantaged people on this planet. It wasn't easy. It was hard and challenging, physically, emotionally, and spiritually. By the end of the week, we were both full and empty. We were filled with both joy and great concern for our neighbors. We were beat. And so on that last night before we returned to Little Rock, I officiated a communion service for all the campers. Together we sat around an open fire, cross-legged on the ground. We shared prayers. We told stories. We gave testimonials. And then I took the elements, the bread and the cup, that were sitting in an old tree stump, and I blessed them. And I invited those youth to come forward with their hands outstretched like this, to receive the bread in their hand and then dip it into the cup, to receive these gifts of God's love for us as expressed through Jesus Christ. And they did. And it was like no other communion service I had ever officiated before or have since. I have to tell you, it was all about those hands. As they came forward, their hands outstretched, I couldn't help but see that they were broken and cut and bruised. They were bandaged. They were band-aided. And yes, there was even dried blood caked on those hands. And in that moment, I realized these are the hands of God's servants. These are the hands of God's servants. Amen, and thanks be to God.
Dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save.
will make their darkness bright? Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have bored my people's pain. I have wept my love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. They turn. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
One of the ways we show our love to one another in these days is by keeping a safe distance from one another. Another way we can show that love is to remember our church by giving generously during this time, to make sure our ministries are strong and our presence is assured. There are many ways to give, and you will see those on your screen. You may text to give or send a check to the church, or you may begin a bank transfer from your bank account. Be blessed by being a blessing to others. Please join me in a word of prayer. God of extravagant love, fill our spirits with your love. And place upon our hearts your call to serve all in the name of Christ. We ask that you dedicate our gifts and our lives to faithful service and ministry. Amen.
please join me in the affirmation of faith. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, or persecution or famine, or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all things, we are more than conquerors through the one who loved us. We are sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
And now our invitation to you from Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church is to know the peace of Christ, which passes all understanding, and to share that peace and love with others. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today at Pulaski Heights United Methodist Church. And I hope you enjoyed our worship service. May the peace, joy, and love of God be with you.
Great, you will be a servant, a slave to all. Go this day as servants of Christ
to give and give and give and transform the world in the name of love. Amen.